kinds of coffees that are offered by Starbucks, if you look at their ingredients, which actually constitute a very small portion of the price, if you look at these various options, you are, I mean, for them, making any of these coffees, it is pretty much the same cost. But, I mean, if you look at the prices, they are quite different from one option to another. When we say price targeting, what we are doing is we are asking the consumer what is he willing to pay. And we're charging that amount to the consumer. So this is one very good example wherein, you know, based upon your choices, you are actually telling Starbucks, I am not price conscious. You know, maybe going with the costlier options, you are actually telling, I am not price conscious, you can charge me more. So if a price targeting, if price targeting is being implemented by an organization, and if it only shifts the consumer base from people who are willing to pay more price to people who are willing to pay less price, you may not actually be benefiting the business. Similarly, what he's also explained is if you want a bargain, do not look for cheaper shops. Shop cheap. Basically, what he means is if you go to a supermarket, you know, there is no scarcity that is available to the supermarket. When we say scarcity, there is no such option that goods that are available in one store are not available in another store. There may be a cost of convenience wherein you may not want to drive down to another store and compare the prices. But at the same time, in the same supermarket, if you are conscious enough and if you look for all the alternative products available, or you know, there are times when they would put the most costliest option on the top shelf because there are not many people who bend down and look for other options, then you are actually paying a much higher price for it. If you as an organization would want to implement price targeting, there are two pitfalls that you may want to beware of. One is prevent price insensitive customer from buying the cheaper option. So I am a person, I do not mind paying higher price, but if I see options that are available which are cheaper, I might actually tend to move towards those. As an organization, that would be a failure. It actually would have, you know, made more profit from a more expensive product, but you would have made lesser. Product leakage from one group to another. So for example, if there are products that are offered to one particular group, like, you know, Apple sells their laptops cheaper to students, and if they in turn buy these products and sell it to some other people making a little more profit, then that is one area wherein you would lose money as an organization. An example of preventing price insensitive customer moving to a cheaper option is, they've taken an example of airline industry. If you see, the first class, the seating in first class as compared to seating in third class, or the lower economy classes, it's not a lot of cost difference to make that much better. But they do not want their first class passengers to move on to those economy class because they would actually lose money on them. Similarly with executive lounges. I mean, the normal lounges are made so shabby that, a good consumer or person who can actually afford a better option wouldn't want to shift to those. So it is primarily because of the fact that they want their loyal or, you know, customers who can pay higher amounts, they do not want them to shift to the inexpensive options is why they do have these differences. Services and products, services and convenience products are most fertile ground for price targeting strategies. When they say that anything that is non-transferable, for example, ticket to Disneyland, you know, they offer it at a 50% discount to people who are local. Now, that cannot be transferred to other individuals, so that may be a good ground for doing the price targeting. Whereas something like DVDs, I mean, the music industry basically wanted to charge different premiums to different regions. Like for US and Europe, they wanted to have different pricing. And that is why they introduced different kind of encryption for each one of these. But then there were options that came up which could actually play all kinds of DVDs from all regions. And that is when your price targeting would fail. You would actually make money on the lower price product than a higher price product. perfect markets, what Tim means by perfect market is a market wherein people trade based on their free will. They are not pushed to make a trade even without their wishes. So what he says is a person would not pay more for a product than what he actually thinks the price of the value of the product is, and another person would not sell the product unless he believes that the price of the money that he is getting is more than the value of the product. So in these kind of markets, you know, price is the one that reveals the information, as in what is the value of the product. This is what is revealed by the price. So most of the products which are available on the free market, they would basically determine their price by themselves. But then, is this the only thing that is available to us? Probably not. There are a lot of non-market activities that would that are also available to us. Something like everything that is available through taxation. When it comes to taxation, I mean, there are a lot of things that we get as a part of paying taxes, like police. In US, it is also healthcare. In UK, it's healthcare, public education. May not be the case in India so much, but yeah, I mean, these are the things available. For all the non-market activities and products, pricing loses one important ingredient, that is information. What he means by that is, you know, if there is a company which is selling particular product X, a person would buy that product X only when he feels there is a value to it. In case the profit percentage is very high, there would be other people who would see this as an opportunity. They would jump into the market, competition would increase, and they would bring down the price. So almost always in a free market, there would not be a huge price difference between, there would not be a huge profit margin. But say in case of a non-market activity like police, what if you wanted to pay more money to get better protection or better healthcare? Can you do that? Not really. So government would never come to know whether they should invest more in police, less in police, or how is it? Because there is no price which is actually telling whether we need more or less. You know, if in case there are inefficient products, we would not buy them and they would die on their own, because there is no market for them. But this is not the case with non-market activities. At the same time, we need both. We need you know, market-driven products as well as non-market-driven products. Why would that be? Because there are cases wherein we would want to support and support those individuals who are at a loss. For example, he's taken an example of old people in US who need heating during the winter season. They may not be in a position to afford that, but we as a society would want to support them. So how do we do that? We do that through taxation. What he suggested here is, in case there was a race and there are, you know, 10 people participating in race, there are some people who are capable and who can run much faster. There are some people who cannot run faster. In case we want to bring equality to them, there are two ways of doing it. One is, we make those people who can run faster to run slow, which is not really the most efficient way. Because in a market, if you ask organizations to produce less or to make lesser profit, that may not be the most efficient way of doing it. The other option is a head start theory, wherein you actually, like a sprint, you actually give a head start to all those people who are in need and who may not be, you know, the best runners. So you would want to give them an equality, and this way would be the most efficient way of actually making the market perform the best outcome. He's taken an example of cross-town traffic, and I think one of the implementations here is from London, wherein they have congestion charges to drive your vehicles in the central part of London. What he said is, markets fail because of multiple reasons. If there is scarcity, in case there are some decision makers lack information, and if there are some decisions that are taken by people who are fed bystanders. So cross-town traffic, or you know, the problem induced by drivers of vehicles, that is of pollution, of sound, of accidents, that affects those people who don't even have a vehicle. Now, why does that happen? That happens because there are certain ingredients of pricing or cost that are paid by those drivers, like the vehicle tax, the cost of petrol, which is, you know, taxed heavily. But at the same time, it is not incentivizing enough, or it is not focusing on the problem. The problem that he mentions here is, let's say if you own a vehicle, you've already paid a one-time fee of buying the vehicle, of road tax, of, you know, petrol or diesel that you consume. But unless and until you see that every time I go to a traffic, I'm actually impacting someone else, is when you would not feel the responsibility of actually reducing that. So what they've suggested here is you should have a cost of every travel. You know, every time you introduce or add to that congestion is when you should be paying for it. This they have termed as externality cost. It's also called marginal pricing. If I have spent money on something as a one-time expense, unless and until I realize the expense of doing, of every transaction, I will not feel the pain of it. So the pricing should actually reflect not only a one-time cost, but also a marginal cost, wherein every time a transaction has to be done, the person has to feel what is the impact of it on others. Tim goes on to mention that as long as there is an information gap between the buyer and the seller, it's always difficult to perform a trade. What he means by that is, for example, in the used car sale, the seller would probably know how much the car is worth, the buyer may not. If the difference is too high, the buyer would never purchase the car, the sale would never happen, and the profits would never happen at all. Same is the case with the insurance companies, wherein when you are purchasing an insurance, if you know that your body is weak, you may want to buy a higher insurance. The insurance company may not know it. Now imagine a case wherein all the healthy people do not want to buy an insurance, whereas all the unhealthy people want to buy insurance. You are actually taking the insurance business to a doom. I mean, the more people who are not very healthy, the more they buy the insurance, the more claim these insurance companies will have to pay. And this entire thing would spiral into doom the organization. So what he suggested is, for the deal to happen, the informed side should build credibility. For example, in the used car sales, the car sales person or the sales company should actually build something like a big car showroom, which would induce credibility. And one of the reasons why a car sale would not happen is the person who is buying the car, if he is not confident about the quality of the car that he is purchasing, he may not want to purchase it. Because let's say if something happens to that vehicle, he would be in no position to go back and, you know, claim a refund or return the vehicle. So what they suggest is you should have, you know, big showrooms wherein you actually show that we are in here to do the business. We'll remain here for some time, for a long time. And in case you have any problems with your vehicle, you can always bring it back. There is no way you can verbally mention how good or bad your car is. So this is one of the ways of establishing those credibilities. Banks take a similar stance wherein they would build large buildings so that people believe in them, and they say that, okay, this bank is there to do business, and you know, it is safe to deposit our money with them. The uninformed side should offer more different deals. What they mean by this is actually implemented by a lot of insurance companies, wherein what they do is, they would offer not only one set of insurance, but insurance at different levels. So what they would do is they would offer, you know, insurance with less premium, but then they would cover less things. They would offer more premium and they would cover more things. That way, individuals who are inter-